me see. Presentation mode. All right. API monitoring. I'm so happy to share our experience because that's what this meeting is all about. Hearing what some company does, hearing, can I use that experience? Do I do it right? Would I do it the same way? So that's what this talk is a bit about. My name is Michael. I work for Jaxxia. I'm one of the developers. So this is back our story. We have infrastructure as a service, platform as a service, and we are building from Jaxxia backend as a service. Who here is familiar with the term backend as a service? Ah, that's quite a few. Now, to be honest, we are not building backend as a service. We're building the next generation backend as a service. So even better. Yeah, of course. They all say that, but we really do. And doing that, we thought to ourselves, what do we really need? We need to get our fingers on your development problems, because what is the number one thing when using APIs? Sooner or later you will hit, it does not work. And we don't want to be the company that says, do it again. So no, we want to help you. So we need some eyes, real time, to support you. So first, how does our stack look like? We are a bit of open source. So what we do is you create a data app, as we call it. So that means you define what you need, a NoSQL, SQL storage. We have it all. We generate automatically RESTful APIs for you, and then you can use our SDKs and program whatever you want. And of course, when you create some application, sooner or later, you need security services, you need some payment modules, you need some CMS. All those kind of services are already there for you to use in your application. Also, of course, in a RESTful way. And we have Nginx, and yeah, a lot of people we think, and we know for sure, are using this platform in future. Currently, we are still in closed beta, where we have a lot of people now testing it for us. And the number of application users, we think maybe 100,000, 200,000, so it will be large. And when it happens, we want to be able to know what is the behavior of our systems, what is happening to solve your problems, of course. So currently, we're still a bit of Node.js, but yeah, we at Jaxxia, we think we take it to the limit, get rid of Node. We're going to Golang. Of course, that's not what this talk is all about. But yeah, it's just a thing that you say, is it real? Not anymore. So we do a few things on infrastructure level. We engineer everything ourselves. So the complete stack back in the service is engineered by ourselves. So we thought, if we say we want to give the best support on this world for programmers, because developers will be our future customers. And we said, yeah, building a distributed system, what we are doing, on large scale, that's hard, but we are doing it. But creating such a monitoring system ourselves, we thought maybe we should have a requirement that we say, we are not programming that ourselves, because that's just another cup of tea. So we said our requirement for having such a tool to assist you with your questions, help me out, I fire a REST API call and I get a strange problem. We said, no programming. If you can find a tool that is already there, let's use it. And of course, it needs to be real time. So, and of course, secure, flexible, yeah, and if it's even possible, easy to use, browser-based, you know, it should be working on every phone. So simple requirements, we think. Holy grail. So we talked to a lot of people. They said, my God, Elastic. Now, we just heard from LeaseWeb. So everybody's talking about, yeah, go down to the Elastic way. It is awesome. And we thought, yeah. We looked at the website. Real time, distributed, scalable, and we thought, if it sounds too good to be true, yeah, maybe it is. So we thought to ourselves, let's take it to the limit, install it on production. We're still in private beta, so yeah, if we break something, our current users, yeah, will accept it. But is it really that good? I want to see some hands. Who here has struggled with Elasticsearch, Kibana things? Who has put his hands on it? Oh, that's not too many, a few, that's good. So for the rest of you, very short, because this is no presentation how it works, but it sets your mind. Elastic is a NoSQL database, and everything you want, you can put it in. It's JSON storage, very simple. And the way to get things in used to be Logtest. Currently, you can also use Beats components, and what is awesome about the Beats components, they are written in Golang. Who here is familiar with Java Ruby, GRuby? Now, if you want to create your own Logtest input filters, you have to program in JRuby. Golang is the language for Beats, and it's fast. There is a module for HTTP monitoring traffic in the Beats platform, and it works. And you can say, all right, directly to Elastic, Kibana Webbase. So that's very easy to use. Logtest currently has 120 options to connect all kinds of databases, systems, middleware things. And Logtest in itself is also very flexible. One very easy picture, because what you can do with Logtest is create input filters, because when you connect it to Elastic, it needs to send it in JSON. Why is there an output filter on Logtest? Anyone? Maybe. No? No one? No? Ah. I just saw some hands. No, I'm just kidding. Maybe you can say, I want things to Elastic, but also to your phone, email, SMS, alerting. So when some string comes in, because it's all flexible searching, Elastic is really a very fast indexing and search engine based on Apache Lucene. That's a kind of a Java library, but Elastic has taken it to the limit with creating all kinds of RESTful APIs on top of it. And you can have multiple output filters for multiple, yeah, storage that you want to have. Input, you can connect directly Twitter, RSS feeds, Mongo, whatever you want, application things. We built a lot of application things and everything has logs, so easy to connect. And yeah, Logtest in itself, you can take it also to the limit, scalable, distributed, multiple data centers. And of course the logs need to be shipped to an instance. You can have multiple instances, you can use FluentD, you can use nowadays one of the Beats components for shipping your log files. So, and you can also do awesome things with the Grok filter. I just saw some people raising their hands and they said, oh, I'm a developer. Regular expressions, people, who is in for it? Oh no. you can, if you want to do work with Logtest and filters, you can really take it to the limit with regular expressions and Grok. It's so powerful. You can also say, I don't need it, but you can enrich your data. You can do everything you want with it. So we installed it on our systems, tested it on different components. We used CentOS 7.02, a lot of other things, and yeah, we said it meets our requirements. It worked already out of the box, without tuning, in real time. And we thought, yeah, if somebody now comes to us and says, yeah, yesterday it worked, but today, I don't know, I've never changed in my code. We've all been there. Nothing is changed in my code, but suddenly it doesn't work. And now we can see, yeah, we see what's happening. It's our fault. Yeah, maintenance, whatever. So it gives us now the possibility to see what is going on, what was going on yesterday, and yeah, Gorg is very powerful, so you can really do very nice things, creating extra information on things coming in from application parts. What we saw also, and yeah, we weren't aware from the start, this stack uses Java. Who here is a really a Java fan? Out. No, kidding. Yeah, we say this stack uses Java. And we say Java is very good, but it's just not the thing that we like. But it's good, but yeah, we thought, gruby. So Ruby on Java, this whole thing on Java, and now we say, oh, all right, they have seen it, they are now going to Golang. But in the end, this is a very flexible architecture. And we thought to ourselves, and that's what we at Jaxa do. Evaluation, people, are we going further with this to production, for real, later on? And we said, maybe we should ask some other people. And we had some discussions, and then we thought, is it good enough for us? And we said, yeah, we can do everything we want, but in the end, when you build an application, maybe you want also to have a dashboard for your customers. Because most of the times when you build an application, you want your customers to give a dashboard. Oh, right, this is what you use, this is what you have consumed. You can challenge your invoice, but these are the statistics. So we thought, yeah, you can do it with Elastic, but we heard about another solution. So we thought that other solution is new. So we thought, yeah, new is it always better? So I want to see some hands. Who here thinks that new is always better? Oh, you're so conservative, people. Jaxa thinks new is, of course, always better. We in our brain, we think we have a lot of knowledge. Things we have done, that works, so we never change it anymore. But that's not what we think. We said, all right, we are open for anything that it comes along, and we investigate what is really new. Is it really good? Is it better than things in the past? So we heard about this concept, and yeah, we thought, the concept is not really new. It's old, very old. So before proceeding, who here has heard of time series databases? Yeah, the old people. Sorry. So we said, everything we do and want to do is time-based. If you have a problem, we want to solve it directly in this time. And when you said an hour ago it worked, yeah, we shift an hour back. So everything that comes in has a timestamp, sooner or later. So a time series database, that is you put all kind of data, just like in a JSON storage without any structure, but one thing very different. Everything has a timestamp. And of course, another nasty question, who here is very familiar with how databases work internally? Mongo, people? Work with MongoDB? All right, now let me, very short. The most hard part of database creation is indexing and doing everything very fast, distributed on large scale. And that's why some time ago, some new thing came along and said Mongo, and we thought, all the people, can you do transactions with that? Yeah, of course, but in a different way. And we thought, new is not always better. With time series database, you have to think, of course, again, is it better? Time series databases were there in the past, but currently we see a lot of use cases where we think, when you optimize your storage for everything based on the timestamp, and you have a massive scale data coming in, a lot of API calls, events, IoT things, sensors, temperatures, whatever, network things, everything has a timestamp. This kind of technology was built for it and has improved very, very much. So we heard about the solution that we found. Yeah, if new is not always better, but maybe this time new can be better. So we tested InfluxDB. So who has ever heard of InfluxDB? Yeah, all right, you're my guy. So what it is, it's written completely in Golang. They use some things from the past for the data store, but they have left it, and it has completely no dependencies left. So it's very clean code. And also, you can have in your mind, we all have some SQL things. So select whatever you want. And all those old things still work, but they have a lot of nice features built in to do some, for instance, percentile, distance, median, all on time scale. So you can say, all right, I want to know who has had the the highest API traffic the last 10 minutes or the last hour. All those kind of functionality is built in. This database is also very good, and we have tested it on continuous querying. That means you define a query. Now, most of the time, when you pay a lot of money, people will develop such a thing, and yeah, your database will need a lot of CPU and power, but this kind of technology has it built in. So data coming in, and instantly you get things out that you have defined. And that is very powerful if you need such kind of things. Also, because yeah, we are building at large, it has to be scalable this way. This is set up with clustering in mind. Is it good, production ready? No, maybe already, but maybe it needs some enhancement, but it's open source, so you can improve it yourself. And of course, this is the API meeting. It has, of course, an API, RESTful API, to control everything you want with it. So, but the big difference with Elastic is NoSQL, but JSON storage. This is also a very NoSQL thing, but it has no JSON storage. It has a more text-based storage, a key format. So it's a line protocol that you say, I have a key, I have a value, and of course everything is timestamped. So everything is indexed on time. So it makes it very fast for writing all those events. We have tested it on a large, on a few systems. We have also created for you to play around. You can download, I think, Marvin, Monday or something from our website, a Docker image with some beach components, log test. So you can play around to say, how does it treat me? How does it feel? Is it really that fast? And of course, you know, when you install this kind of technology, you have to use, in the end, solid state drives, of course. But to get familiar with this kind of tools, yeah, you can say, all right, I want to see how it works with Grafana or Kibana. And that's also the power of this kind of technology. When we say, all right, when something breaks for a customer developer, we want to have eyes, and we don't want to stuck with Grafana or Kibana. We want to switch if needed. And some people like Kibana, others say, all right, I go for Grafana, much more modules, much more dashboards. So yeah, it's easy to switch. Are we there yet? At Jaxia, we like to rethink what is data on large scale. So we challenge our thinking, because we know in future, data will grow, data users will grow, Internet of Things will come along. We heard all about big data and all kind of magic going on, and we said, yeah, maybe sometimes it's good to reset our minds. We like solutions that work. Does it mean that we say, all right, we're going for Elastic or Influx or both? Maybe yes, maybe no. It depends what you want. So let's hear it. Discussions, questions, people. Yeah, the question is, someone is building or using Elastic for voice over IP data. It grows and grows, and you have some scalability issues.
I need to convince, I'm the product owner, really all right. Convinced the developer that I'm chatting with, and I'm saying, you need to look at this, and then
we took Elastic a bit to the limit to say, all right, you can create shards. How fast is it? What can you do on what kind of scale? For instance, Stack Exchange uses it. So that's we looked at other companies, but also their architecture. And the number one thing that you find on the Elasticsearch is never tune the Java GVM. Because when data comes in and you say, I want data out, yeah, that is a different process, because indexing is one, getting data out is another. And you can optimize it by tuning a lot of things. You say, I want it very fast indexing. Yeah, searching it can be after 5 minutes then. Scaling and scalability, you can create all kind of shards, and yeah, you can take it really to the limit. But it depends really on your issue, also on the indexes you have. But if you really say, I only have things timestamps, maybe you should give it a try, the InfluxDB, to say, is that really easier? Because we thought, we have seen you have less options to tune. So maybe your problem is becoming less difficult. And we think if you're using this kind of options, a couple of terabytes, 10, 20, yeah, it should keep on working, of course. That's why it's built for. But I can't give a solid answer, of course, on your specific use case. But you're not alone with these kind of questions. And notice that Elastic does nightly benchmark on every new build. And it's awesome what they do on performance.
Did you try to make indexes per...
I need to ask my developer. I'm always the guy who throws in the term and then...
All right,
Because we have very good experience with Elasticsearch with periodical indexes.
Yeah, indexing can really speed things up, the way you create indexes, or can filter things out. But yeah, it really depends on what issues you have. So you have to really have some eyes on some experts. Do you really know how Apache Lucene works? Kind of argument. And yeah, it's very hard, because also to us, it's a bit a black box. It's so powerful because everything on one, you can get out, but when it gets slower, you think, where is the error? What is going on? Where is it busy with? So, yeah. Other questions, people? Now, then, yeah.
Are you running
the Not yet. We are currently, as Jaksha, in private beta. So we have tested some Elastic on our, as we call it, production data stack. Influx, we have tested it on a more proof of concept stack, but we are in doubt what do we go for and on what scale and when with Influx, because there are also a couple of things both with Elastic and Influx, for instance security, that we think before taking it really to production and offer also customers their own dashboard, we need to engineer a bit more. And yeah, that was one of our requirements. We don't like to program everything ourselves, so we're still in doubt what to do.
And are you using clustering in InfluxDB?
Not yet. We looked at it, and you know how it works.
Yeah.
So it's kind of tricky if you want to do now, and that's why I said, if you're really going for InfluxDB and the clustering, it needs a little work. So if you can program Go, welcome at our company and make it better.
Hey, thank you, Michael.
Thank you.